Hello, I'm Alex, and welcome to the History Chronicles. If you like our work, then please don't forget to like and subscribe. And if you'd like to support the channel in return for exclusive perks, please visit our Patreon page. Now, on with the video. How did Stalin die? Was his death natural? Or was he poisoned by his entourage? Let's find out in today's episode of the History Chronicles. Today's History Chronicle begins on the 1st of March 1953 in Moscow, in one of the residences of the leader of the USSR. Contrary to the usual schedule, Joseph Stalin did not leave his private apartment that afternoon. Not trusting even the closest people, he preferred to rest alone behind closed doors. However, after the master, as his closest servants called him, missed breakfast and lunch, the guards began to worry, but despite the obvious signs of trouble, Stalin's guards were indecisive over what to do. The reason for this behaviour was a mortal fear of a cruel master. But late in the evening, on the 1st of March at 10:30 p.m, one guard on duty did violate Stalin's strict order and entered his private apartments. He found the master lying unconscious on the floor in a puddle of urine. The frightened guard raised the alarm. A terrible commotion began in Stalin's palace. The guards were ready to protect him from enemy attacks at the cost of their lives, but were completely unprepared to see their formidable master in a completely helpless state. Finally, Stalin's servants began to act. The master was moved from the room in which he was found unconscious into the large dining room. They put him on the sofa and covered him with a blanket. However, none of Stalin's servants called a doctor, as might be expected in such a situation. Instead, the guards began calling Stalin's deputies, Nikita Khrushchev, Lavrenty Beria, and Georgi Malenkov, and they asked for orders for what to do next. Stalin's deputies on the phone ordered the guards to do nothing until their arrival. Malenkov, Khrushchev, and Beria arrived at Stalin's residence almost simultaneously. They were extremely suspicious of the story of the guard on duty who found the master lying unconscious. They had serious reasons for such doubts. Less than a day had passed since the night of the 28th of February, when they all had dinner together at a luxurious table in the master's private apartments. Malenkov, Khrushchev, and Beria were part of Stalin's so-called inner circle, and were so young they could have been Stalin's sons. Stalin, under the influence of wine, was cheerful and rudely joked about his, quote, sons. However, they all knew that the wrong reaction to this kind of joke could cost them their lives. When Stalin's deputies left the residence of the head of state early in the morning at 4 a.m. on the 1st of March, the master was in good spirits and nothing foreshadowed what was to come. After conferring in front of the closed doors of Stalin's apartments, Malenkov, Khrushchev, and Beria decided to personally find out what had happened to the master. They very carefully tiptoed into the room where Stalin was. Malenkov even took off his new leather shoes so that their creaking would not disturb the strict master. What they saw could have been another prank of their beloved father. Stalin was lying on the sofa, covered with a blanket, and seemed to be sleeping peacefully. They did not see any external signs of anything wrong. At one point, it even seemed to them that Stalin would wake up and, enraged by the invasion of his private apartments, scold them like naughty children. In fear, Malenkov, Khrushchev, and Beria left the room and were about to leave the residence as they were annoyed by the seemingly incorrect information from Stalin's guards. The only person who was able to convince the top leaders of the USSR that all was not well was a woman who was one of Stalin's servants. Crying, she convinced them that her master was seriously ill and begged them to order doctors to be called. To this, one of them replied that Comrade Stalin was just resting and it was not worth bothering him. However, her emotion in the circumstances made them think twice. Finally, the top Soviet leaders realized that something terrible had happened to Stalin. In the dead of night, they ordered the best doctors to his bedside to treat the leader. But up to this time, the seriously ill Stalin had continued to lie on the couch without medical assistance. Only in the early morning of the 2nd of March did doctors arrive at the residence of the head of the USSR. They immediately diagnosed Stalin with a severe stroke, accompanied by paralysis of the right side of the body and a persistent loss of consciousness. The patient's condition was critical. There was no hope that he would survive. Before their arrival, the seriously ill Stalin did not receive any medical care for more than a day. However, on the morning of the 2nd of March, the situation reversed. There were too many doctors around Stalin, but they were powerless to help the dying man. They had no choice but to log every minute all the changes in the vital signs of this high-ranking patient and wait for his inevitable death. How was it that in the residence where the chronically ill Stalin lived permanently, there was not at least one doctor who could provide emergency assistance at the right time? Who made such a monstrous mistake? Why, unlike Hitler, did Stalin not have a personal doctor who could constantly monitor his physical condition? It turns out that the categorical order not to let doctors into the residence was given by the master himself. Stalin, who was often ill, was terrified of doctors and was convinced that they wanted to poison him. He categorically refused to listen to their advice and take the prescribed medications. The culmination of Stalin's pathological fears of doctors was the criminal case of, quote, killer doctors, fabricated in 1952 on his orders. The cause of his paranoia in this case was the death of several Stalinist confidants who had long suffered from severe chronic diseases. Unable to withstand the cruel tortures of the KGB executioners, many of the arrested doctors confessed their guilt and gave false testimonies about the non-existent crimes of their colleagues. On Stalin's order, the records of the interrogations of the killer doctors were sent to him for review. In the last year of his life, these texts became his favourite reading. Stalin never for a moment doubted the guilt of the doctors and was therefore also very afraid for his own life. The time soon came when Stalin felt that he could no longer single-handedly rule the giant Red Empire. In October 1952, Stalin personally initiated the process of transferring part of his powers to manage the USSR to his most trusted servants. At the same time, the pathologically suspicious master, fearing betrayal, deliberately divided power between the three most devoted sons. However, Khrushchev, Malenkov, and Beria, who knew the master's character perfectly well, were not happy about the new high positions in the top leadership of the USSR. Stalin often arranged brutal tests for his deputies, provoking them to rash actions and, thereby, seeking to expose any secret motives. It was the atmosphere of total fear created by the pathologically cruel master that caused the strange insensitivity and indecision shown by everyone who found themselves next to the terminally ill and helpless Stalin on the night of the 1st of March. From the 2nd of March to the 5th of March 1953, the best Soviet doctors were on duty near the doomed Stalin. His condition was too serious to transport him to the hospital. All medical interventions had to be carried out on the sofa in Stalin's private apartments. On the 3rd of March, the patient's serious condition worsened and became close to critical. Doctors observed Stalin's persistent respiratory and heart failures. The patient sank into an even deeper coma. Although Stalin was doomed, the doctors, fearing accusations of murder, took all possible measures to save him. The only artificial respiration apparatus in the USSR was found for Stalin. At that time, it was a device of enormous size and complex in appearance. However, frightened by the size and incomprehensible functions of the miracle device, the guards would not allow doctors to use the ventilator to support Stalin's life. The patient's condition continued to deteriorate rapidly. On the 5th of March, at 9:50 p.m, Stalin died. The official announcement of the death of the head of the USSR was made on Soviet state radio at 6:30 a.m. on the 6th of March 1953. From daily newspaper publications, Soviet citizens already knew about the serious illness of the head of state, but the reaction to the news of Stalin's death turned out to be very emotional. Millions of Soviet citizens cried sincerely, holding a portrait of their beloved Stalin in their hands. Millions of Gulag prisoners, who learned about the death of their tormentor, whispered this joyful news to each other. However, despite the polarization of emotions, all the citizens of the Soviet Union were united by a common knowledge of the imminent global changes that would inevitably occur after Stalin's death. Meanwhile, Khrushchev, Malenkov, and Beria were feverishly preparing a grand funeral ceremony for Stalin. This pompous event bore a striking resemblance to the burial of the pharaohs of ancient Egypt, whom the Egyptians considered to be gods. Stalin's body was subjected to a special secret embalming procedure. His brain, cut into thousands of the tiniest layers, was sent for storage to a special scientific institution. Before the burial, the coffin with the embalmed body of the leader was put on public display in a giant hall. All the top leaders of the Soviet Union and the Communist Party were on duty next to him, alternately replacing each other. A giant string of Soviet citizens wishing to say goodbye to Stalin moved endlessly past the coffin of the leader. The farewell lasted for 3 days and three nights. On the 9th of March 1953, the coffin with Stalin's body, carried by Soviet leaders, was brought into a mausoleum shaped like an Egyptian pyramid. There, the body was installed next to the mummy of the founder of the Soviet state, Vladimir Lenin. However, the solemnity of the funeral was to be overshadowed by a tragedy. A terrible crush began among tens of thousands of residents of Moscow and visitors from all over the Soviet Union who wanted to see off their beloved Stalin on his last journey. As a result of this incident, several hundred people were killed in the Trubnaya Square area of Moscow. This tragic incident was hidden by the Soviet authorities, and the data on the number of deaths is classified information. To this day, Russian and foreign historians still argue about the causes of the death of Stalin. Many people express the opinion that his death was caused by poison, allegedly placed by his closest servants in a bottle of mineral water. The subject of poisons and their use to kill political rivals was very topical for the Stalin era. Supporting the version of events that Stalin was poisoned is the fact that all his security personnel were replaced at the beginning of 1953. Moreover, in December 1952, the head of Stalin's guard, General Nikolai Vlasic, was arrested during the Killer Doctors case and sent to prison. On the day of the fatal stroke of the master, several posts of the numerous guards of the Stalin residence were unattended, which opened the way for secret access into his private apartments. A bottle of mineral water, from which the master drank on the eve of his stroke, mysteriously disappeared. In the documents pertaining to Stalin's medical history, which were declassified after the collapse of the USSR, there are signs of falsification as well as the absence of the results of important medical tests. However, despite the best efforts of researchers obsessed with this version of events, no direct evidence of poisoning as the cause of Stalin's death has yet to be found. The state of Stalin's health was a closely guarded secret in the Soviet Union. In all official photos and newsreel footage, he appeared to the Soviet people who adored him as an elderly but a quite cheerful and strong 74-year-old man. The true state of the leader's health was known only to a few of his closest servants. For the last few years of his life, this man, who concentrated absolute power in his hands, was in fact seriously ill. In 1946, 1947, and 1951, Stalin's illnesses worsened to such an extent that he was close to death. Shortly before the end of his life, Stalin was forced to quit smoking and throw away his beloved pipe, which became a trademark of this communist tyrant. Finally, there is objective evidence that the death of the master may have been due to natural causes. At the autopsy of his body, pathologists stated that Stalin showed signs of 3 major and about 19 minor strokes that he had suffered during the last few years of his life. The third massive stroke, which occurred on the 1st of March 1953, caused his death. This small, mustachioed man caused the death of millions of Soviet citizens during the 29 years of his rule. According to official data alone, more than 800,000 people were shot on his orders, and more than 3 million political prisoners were arrested and thrown into gulag camps, many of them dying of cold and overwork. Also, because of his criminal domestic policy, millions of Soviet citizens, including women and children, died of starvation. Entire peoples, who, according to Stalin, collaborated with the Nazis, were forcibly resettled in Siberia and Kazakhstan. Stalin's death can rightly be seen as a turning point in the life of the giant Red Empire and its numerous satellites, and in many ways, was the first step towards the collapse of the Soviet Union. You have been watching the History Chronicles. We'd love to know what you think of the death of Stalin. Please let us know below, and if you enjoyed our video, please give us a like and subscribe. It really helps us out. Also, if you'd like to support our work going forward, please visit our Patreon page. And we look forward to seeing you again on the next episode of the History Chronicles.